Now, here's the sternum, this view. And the sternum, it's a flat and a dagger-shaped bone that forms the middle part of the anterior thoracic wall, as you can observe right here. And it has three parts. It has a manubrium, it has a body, and it has a xiphoid process. Now, starting with the manubrium, I'm gonna start right here at the top. The manubrium is the, it has a couple of areas that are important, right? Its superior border, for example, it's approximately in the same horizontal plane as T2 and T3. And so its superior border has a midline notch. I'm gonna try and just draw this so that it's easier to observe. So it has this midline notch right here, where the jugular notch is, basically, also known as suprasternal notch. On each side of the jugular notch, there is a clavicular notch for articulation right here, and with the sternal medial end of the clavicle at the sternoclavicular joint, that's what we call it. And then the upper part of its lateral border has a costal notch for the first costal cartilage right there. Now the body of the sternum, it's located at the level of T5 to T9. So you can see T6, T5, all the way to T9, body of the sternum. And this one, it has, the lateral border has costal notches for articulations with the third to the sixth costal cartilages, as you can see right here. And they also have an anterior surface that is often marked by a transverse ridges, right? These represent the lines of fusion between the segmental elements from which this part sternum originates embryologically. So in other words, what this means is that this part of the bone, the manubrium, used to be separated from this part of the sternum, from the body of the sternum, as well as the xiphoid process. They all were detached at some point, but eventually they fused together to form the sternum. So this fusion of the sternobri occurs between puberty and 25 years of age, approximately. Now, also we have this xiphoid process, which is the smallest and most variable part of the sternum, and it's located at the level of T10, as you can observe right here. It's often pointed, but it can be bifid or perforated in some cases. And the upper part of the lateral border has a facet for articulation with the lower part of the seventh costal cartilage. So in this particular app, you cannot see it very well, but there's some variations usually. And it articulates with the body at the cisternal joint. This is a cartilaginous joint that is usually replaced by bone by approximately the 40th year of life, basically. This cisternal joint marks the lower limit of the central part of the thoracic cavity. So just for reference, we're looking at, we're looking at this part right here. And this is a landmark in the midline for the upper surface of the liver, the diaphragm, and the lower border of the heart. Now, let's take a look at the joints of the thorax. First of all, we're gonna go over the costal vertebral joints. These are joints that are, as the name implies, they are established between the ribs and the vertebral column. And so they include the joint of the head of the rib and the costal transverse joint. So the joint of the head of the rib, these is considered a synovial joint. And it's the heads of the first and lower third ribs that articulate only with the vertebral body of the numerical corresponding thoracic vertebrae. And so the heads of the second to the ninth rib, They articulate with the body of numerically corresponding thoracic vertebrae, the body of the vertebra above, and the intervening intervertebral disc. So as you can see, there are some exceptions here. The joint capsule is going to be reinforced anteriorly by a radiate ligament of the head of the rib, and there's going to be an intra-articular ligament which connects the crest of the head of the rib to the intervertebral disc. Now, as I said before, there's these costotransverse joints, which are synovial joints between the tubercles of the rib and the transverse costal facet of several thoracic vertebrae, as you can observe right here. And so these costotransverse ligaments, for example, they're going to be here, and they're going to pass from posterior aspect of the neck of the rib to the anterior aspect of the corresponding transverse process. So I'm going to attempt to draw it here. This is going to be on this area right here. And so they also have this lateral costotransverse ligament that passes from the tubercle of the rib to the tip of the corresponding transverse process, so in that direction, basically. And the superior costotransverse ligament that passes from the upper border of the neck of the rib, or the crest of the neck of the rib, to the transverse process superior to it, so basically like in that way also. We're going to have the sternocostal or sternochondral joints. I'm going to attempt to draw them real quickly. So we got, for example, these joints between the costal cartilage and the sternum right there. We also have, for example, the first costal cartilage joints directly in the manubrium of the sternum with no cavity between them. The second to the seventh costal cartilage that are usually forming small synovial joints, so from the second all the way down. And so these have a very small cavity between the cartilage and the sternum. There's also the interchondral joints, which are joints between the adjacent costal cartilages, mainly between the 7th to the 10th costal cartilages, so around this area right here. But they may involve also the 5th and 6th costal cartilages. These are usually synovial joints, and they contribute to form the costal margin. And then there is the manubriosternal and stiffsternal joints. So here is the manubriosternal joint, and here is the stiffsternal joint, right? These are secondary cartilaginous joints or symphyses between the manubrium and the body of the sternum, and between the body of the sternum and the xiphoid process, respectively. Now let's talk about the movement of the thoracic wall. First, we're going to go for inspiration. And so, as you can observe here, during inspiration, the ribs are going to be elevated. So let's see, you see how the ribs are being elevated on this view right now. So the volume of the thoracic cage increases. There's going to be an intrathoracic pressure that decreases, and the air is drawn into the lungs. That's why this is so important to happen. And so the diaphragm, I'm going to shift it here so you can observe the diaphragm, right, during inspiration. The diaphragm contracts and descends, as you can observe right there, right, and it increases the vertical diameter of the thoracic cavity, right. During this process, there's going to be the elevation of the ribs has two components. One is that there's a bucket handle-like movement, as you can observe. This increases the transverse diameter of the thoracic cavity. And there's going to be like a pump handle-like movement, which increases the anterior-posterior diameter of the thoracic cavity. Now, on the contrary, we have expiration, right? And during expiration, the ribs are depressed, as you can observe right here. And for this, the volume of the thoracic cage, it's going to decrease. There's going to be an intrathoracic pressure that increases, and the air, it's expelled from the lungs. In this process of expiration right? There's also something that we call, like, this is what we call quiet expiration, which is a passive process. And this results from the elastic recoil of the lungs and the thoracic cage. Now, in the process of expiration, we can also have what we call forced expiration, in which the muscles that depress the ribs are recruited. For example, the internal intercostals, which are deep to the external intercostals, and the abdominal muscles. And this is an active process. Meanwhile, for the process of inspiration is more of an active process, and this requires muscle contraction. The main muscles of inspiration, it's obviously going to be the diaphragm right here and the internal intercostals. And during forced inspiration, other muscles that can elevate the ribs are recruited, such as the sternocleidomastoid. And for example, the scalene muscles, right? You can see, for example, some of them right here. And for example, the pectoralis minor. In this view, we can now observe all of the muscles that are in the thorax for breathing, like we were talking about the diaphragm just a second ago. But now we're gonna go over some of the intercostal muscles. For example, I'm gonna start with the external intercostal muscles. These are 11 pairs of muscles that fill the intercostal spaces. As you can see right here, these are your ribs, right? So they're in between the ribs. And these muscles are, like I said, they are in their intercostal spaces from the costal tubercles to close the junction between these ribs and their costal cartilages anteriorly. So from this point to the sternum, they are replaced by a fibrous membrane. So as you can see, they don't reach the area of the sternum. They are basically coming all the way from the posterior side of the thorax to the anterior side, but they don't reach the sternum, as I just said. So there's going to be a fibrous membrane known as the external intercostal membrane. And basically, this is what it's going to allow them to connect in a way, to the sternum. We also have the internal intercostals. These are also 11 pairs of muscles that fill the intercostal spaces from the lateral border of the sternum, as you can see right here, anteriorly to the costal angles posteriorly, as you can see right there. This muscle basically has, it comes from the costal angles to the costal tubercles, and they are replaced by a fibrous membrane known as the internal intercostal membrane. And these fibers run perpendicular to those of the external intercostal, posteriorly and inferiorly when viewed from one side. So again, as you can see, the fibers run in a different direction. Other thoracic muscles include the subcostal muscles, which we can see right here. This is a posterior view, as you can observe, posteriorly on the thorax. And so these subcostal muscles, they are more numerous in the lower part of the thoracic wall. They descend from the internal surface of one rib to the internal surface of the second and or third rib below. And the fibers, as you can observe right here, they run parallel to those of the internal and innermost intercostal muscles. We also have another muscle internal to the sternum in the thoracic cavity, known as the transversus thoracis. Here's one side of the muscle, here's the other side. Kind of looks like a spider web. And this muscle, the transversus thoracics, also known as sternocostalis, is located on the internal surface of the anterior thoracic wall. As you can see, it originates from the posterior surface of the xiphoid process and the lower part of the body of the sternum. Let me try and zoom in here so you can observe it very well. And this inserts into the second to the sixth costal cartilages. These muscles, subcostals and transversus thoracics, are supplied by the intercostal nerves, and probably we think that they depress the ribs and the costal cartilages, respectively.